Randy sent me the text of scripture many of you are reading through, and there's a lot there. So hopefully most of you have read through that, and we'll try to cover some of it. Some of the reading was in Deuteronomy 4:2. In that, there's a text that says, do not add to God's word and do not take away from it. I think that's been the cause of a lot of division, a lot of problems, as people forget some of God's word, and also as people add to his word. And so many times, I like to say I'm from Missouri, show me, the show me state. So if you're going to tell me to do something, and you say God said it, I might ask you, show me where. And then I may ask you, show me three times. And then I may ask you, show me in the New Testament. And then when you've shown me, and when I recognize I've been doing it wrong, hopefully I'll start doing it right. So let's look in Genesis 2. And there's a slide I've asked, and I don't know if we got it. The first slide says, how many prohibitions did God give Adam and Eve? And I don't know if that made it through all the internet and all that. Yeah. So a prohibition is something you shall not do. And so this, I like interactive. I'm more of a missionary than I am a preacher. So in many foreign countries, people will just stand up and say something or ask a question. You'll make me feel right at home if you do that. And I may or may not have an answer. So I'm going to ask you a question. How many things did God tell Adam and Eve they couldn't do? It's a number between 1 and 100. There you go, 1. If you didn't get it, I was going to say it's the number between 1 and 1. Okay, so let's see what that one thing was. In Genesis 2, starting in verse 16, we'll read this. And the Lord God commanded the man, you are free to eat from any of the tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And when you eat it, you will surely die. Okay, there's a couple of words there. Some of you I know have gone to Northman years ago. There was an old preacher man, George Fall, who was a real student of the word. And George really picked this apart and I think really helped me to get a firm understanding about divisions in the Lord's body. So let's look and see if when Eve and Satan requote this, if they quote it correctly or if they're guilty of adding to it and taking away from it. So let's drop down to Genesis 3. It's going to be the fall of man. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God really say? Now Satan's always going to bring God's word into question. You must not eat from any tree in the garden. Now Satan's asking, now God said something similar to that. What did God say? Did he say you couldn't eat from any tree in the garden? No, he said you may freely eat. So if you've got children, or if you've had children or grandchildren, you go someplace that maybe didn't have children, and there's a bowl of goodies standing there, and that person says to your children or grandchildren, help yourself. How many is going to be left? None. Because your kids are not used to hearing help yourself. I mean, they're going to take it all. I recall my children doing that at the bank one day. My wife worked at the bank. There was a gal there who didn't have kids. Says, you girls help yourself. Well, they did. And that's what God wants us to do. He wants us to freely enjoy the good things. He doesn't withhold anything from us. But Satan wants God to be a bully. So he misquotes the word and says, God said, you can't eat from any of the trees. And then the woman said to the serpent, we may eat. She took out freely. She also made God be stingy. God is not stingy. He's the giver of every good and every gift. Every good and every gift. I get my language mixed up here. From the trees in the garden. But God did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it. Did God say you couldn't touch it? Did God say you couldn't touch the fruit? No, you see, that's that problem. Satan wants us to just get close as we can to that line. Oh, doesn't that look good? Oh, wouldn't that be fun? Oh, wouldn't you enjoy it? He wants us to get right close to that line and then thinking, oh, you've already sinned. God didn't say you must not touch it. And then she also said, if anybody has the King James, lest you die. And this is old language. Peradventure, you might die. God didn't say you might die. God said what? You will surely die. See, when you add to God's word, you take away from God's word, or you make it stronger than his word, we're going to have problems. So if somebody challenges me to do something different, show me in the word. Show me where God said it three times. Let me read it myself. Don't print out something you've printed with scripture text on there. I want to see it in the Bible. And hopefully you will have that same attitude. God's loving us. God wants us to be in communion with him. Okay, our next slide may say something like, let's see what the next slide is. See if we get, how many commandments did Moses have? Commandments. Yeah, it's between 1 and 11. 10. Okay. Then afterwards, there was a bunch of laws. Anybody got a clue? And we'll round that off to 100 even. How many laws were added to the Ten Commandments? 613, 17, 22, 6. Pretty close. Student of the word here. Okay. Now, those were from God. Now the Levitical priest got together and added a few more from men. How many more were added to the 10 plus the 613, give or take? Give or take about 1,500 more onto the 610 or 613 plus 10, 623 and 1,500 if you're good at math. There's a whole bunch there. So Deuteronomy 22, if we take a peek at that, there are some do's and don'ts. And on that do's and don'ts, if you look in verse 9, just for example, it says, do not plant two kinds of seed in your vineyard. If you do, only the crops you plant, but also the fruit of your vineyard will be defiled. Do not plow with an ox and a donkey yoked together. Do not wear clothes of wool and linen woven together. Okay, now that's kind of a copy of Leviticus 19. And this Leviticus 19... in verse 28, is a famous verse for some older folks, probably my age and older. Now, I don't want you to raise hands. This is kind of interactive in your brain. Anybody here have a tattoo? You don't have to raise your hand. Anybody here who has a tattoo ever been scorned or looked down upon? And then someone with their Bible is going to show you in Leviticus 19 where my dad shouldn't have the Marine Corps emblem on his arm. Or anything else for that matter. And they're going to read to you, do not cut your bodies for the dead or put tattoo marks on yourselves. I am the Lord. Says it right there in Leviticus 19. But also, any of you folks have a garden? Come, this one I want you to hear. Anybody got a garden this year? What did you have in it? Corn, peas, beans. What did you have in your garden? Tomatoes, corn. Anybody have more than one thing in their garden? Uh-oh. I thought we just read God said don't put more than one thing in your garden. So should you want to pick up a rock and heave it at somebody with a tattoo on them and you got more than one thing in your garden, you might be in trouble. Now, if you're a real friendly group, you could look at the person in front of you. I don't suggest this, but look at the back of their lapel of their shirt. More than likely, it's going to have more than one thing woven in it. Some have 100% cotton. I just say, bless you. But if you're male, do you have a beard? Right here in the front, thank you for the sideburns. And you're the man, okay? The rest of us, I tried to grow some today. I didn't shave on purpose so I wouldn't be going to hell because the same scripture says don't shave the side of your beard. Okay, so you made it today. You cut the grade unless your garden's messed up. The point to all this is, this was written to the Jews. I'm not a Jew. This was written in the Old Testament. A bunch of do's and don'ts in there, but if you're going to condemn someone for having a tattoo, let's make sure we're wearing 100% cotton and that we didn't put peas and carrots in the same garden and that we don't throw rocks in a glass house. It's Old Testament. So I've taken that verse and just scared some people badly. I was having an airplane motor rebuilt in Florida, and I was just a guest there. And I'm working in this hangar, and apparently a grandmother and a young lady came in to tour, and there were the people who did Through the Gates of Splendor, Steve Saint. He was a missionary to Ecuador and was martyred there. At any rate, Young girl comes, she's got a few tattoos on her. Many times they're just, you know, it's honoring a sister who passed away or a child or something. There's some really good stuff on there. And if we'd just be a little compassionate, we might learn something. But I went right up to him and said, you know, you're going right straight to hell for that. And the grandmother gasped, you know, and the people who ran the place gasped, like, who is this idiot? These could be donors. What are you doing? You're scaring them off. And I said, no, I bet you get that a lot. Here, let me show you in the Word where people who have two different kind of clothing woven together, that they're just in the same case here. But God's a God of love and grace. So let's have a little bit more love and a little bit more grace, and maybe we applaud those who are bold enough to have a tattoo, and maybe if we talk to them, they might really have a good message on there. So let's get to know them a little bit. So then I have a slide, I think, that might say sign everywhere, sign. It might be before that one. And we got that. Or it might be a little intro clip with a song. And if we don't have that, be careful because I might sing it. Yeah, now we're going to get some action. And we'll try that. Some of you my age might remember this, and it's just a thing to remember. Sign, everywhere a sign. Blocking up the scenery, blowing my mind. Do this, don't do that, can't you read the sign? And then at the end it says, the sign said, everybody welcome, come in the heartbreak. I didn't have a thing to pay, so I got me a pen and a paper, and I made my own little sign. It said, hello, God, how are you? I'm alive and doing fine. Sign, everywhere a sign. Blocking up the scenery, blowing my mind. Do this, don't do that, can't you read the sign? Okay, that's an old one. That's the only song you're going to get out of me. So you can thank the technology people who I didn't get that right to for that one. So do this, don't do that. James, the half-brother of Jesus Christ, said, he who knows the right to do and doesn't do it sins. Sometimes we do the things we ought not to do, and we don't do the things we ought to do. I'm guilty of that. Also in the book of James 1:27 says, pure religion, who can find it? Pure religion is this. It's an open book test. Pure religion is to look after widows and orphans in their distress. And the second part of that, if we read it all, is keep yourself from being polluted by the world. Many times we're guilty of that. We might be getting all the stuff right in line. We don't have any tattoos. We only got tomatoes in our garden. We let our beard grow long. But then we get hung up in the world. And we just get all embroiled in all the nonsense that's going on. And we lose our witness for God. Be careful of that. So what's in the Word? What counts? We see in Psalm, and through this whole theme, there's a lot of Psalms, there's a lot in Deuteronomy. I see a theme through the reading for this week of sin. Then recognition of our sin. Then crying out to God to help us from our sin. Confession of our sin. And then we see that God forgives our sin. One of those greatest ones is in Psalm 51. David, I think just shortly after his little tryst with Bathsheba. That one bothers me a lot. You know, David, a man after God's own heart, had this little extramarital thing and also actually had that husband killed. Sent him right into war, right into the front. Yet it was his heart that God was looking at. Afterwards, when David realized, when Nathan came to him, and at that point, I don't really know where David was, but when Nathan confronted him with the story about the sheep, David's heart was broken. And I cried out, I think, in Psalm 51, God, create in me a pure heart, O Lord, and then I will teach others their ways. You see, when we're in the middle of our own mire, it's awfully hard with any confidence to go tell someone else, maybe you ought to consider changing this or consider doing this way. Now, we'll never be perfect, because our other scripture reading this week told us over and over again, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Not one can be found righteous. We're only made righteous through God. There's a big word called justified. Justified, as I was taught when I was teaching seventh grade Sunday school. Did you catch that? I was taught when I was teaching. So normally the teacher gets more learning than the students do. And many of my students at that time, one of them is our preacher in Kalkaska now, Andy Bratton. Well, Andy Bratton's dad was Eddie Bratton. And so the preacher's kid, of course, knew more than the seventh grade Sunday school teacher. And several of the elders' kids were in there. And so he learned me several things. So as I was teaching, he taught me many, many things. All of sin falls short of the glory of God. Justified. Just if I'd never sinned. So that's a big multi-syllable word. But when we repent of our sins and Christ's blood washes us clean, he makes us like a newborn baby. Just if I'd never sinned. So justified is a great place to be. You can't say that you're sinless, but hopefully we sin less. So hopefully we sin less today than we did yesterday. And hopefully tomorrow we'll sin less than we did today. So recognizing our sin is a beautiful thing, but we can't let that sin weigh us down. One of your other readings this week was Psalm 103, one of my favorites. As high as the heaven is from the earth, as far as the east is from the west. Now, I sometimes get geographically challenged, but I think east is that way because I think the sun kind of set down over this way. Is that correct? And Canada might be north of us. And then down here south is one of us trolls live down that way, but that's okay. I've recognized, I've come to grips with that. I live under the bridge. They tell me if you go north far enough, what do we hit? There's a pole up there, Santa Lou. What's north all the way? Okay, and what's south all the way? Thank you. Just because he didn't shave his, he's got all that knowledge, is just overwhelmed him now. Thank you again. Okay, but how about if we go east? What happens if we go east all the way? Where do we end up? Yeah, we're going to come back here. And if we go west, is there a west pole? Isn't that neat that God said that? You know, I could just think he's only forgiven my sin up to the North Pole. What happens after that? Because I'm a big sinner. And if he just forgave him as far as the South Pole, I'm in deep trouble. Because once he gets there, there's more sin. But when he forgave him as far as the east is from the west, that's how far he stretched out his arms. And said, you're forgiven. As far as the east is from the west. Now, unlike a human being, God did this. He forgave our sins, and he remembers them no more. How about that for a deal? We can forgive somebody, but I'm not going to forget it. You know what you said the other day? I forgive you for it, brother, but I'm not going to forget it. You're not going to do me twice. That's from my dad, not from my father. My dad said, woe be it to you if somebody messes you over once. Woe be it to you if you let him mess over you twice. How many times have we messed over God? Only once. You see, he forgot it. All those times we messed over God, and you ask him, how many times have we messed over you, God? He said, well, just the one you did today. Isn't that amazing? When there's multitude, a pile of sin, sin on top of sin, all the way from the time we chose to do wrong against God, God only remembers the one you haven't asked him to forgive you of. And he's waiting to forgive you of that. That's an awesome God. That's a really good deal. To trade your sorrows, to trade all your burdens, that God will wash you and forgive you. We ought to take him up on that. All it takes is a repentant heart. We just need to repent of our sins, ask God to forgive us. If we've never been immersed, we need to take that step in obedience that God would wash us clean and give us that new life. Now, in the book of Romans, Romans 6, as we come through Romans chapter 3 to chapter 5, and we end up in chapter 6, and we've got one more slide up there. It talks about grace. G-R-A-C-E. Young lady, I used to speak at Excelsior Church of Christ. I think is the first one who showed me this. Grace. We'd all like grace. And most of Paul's letter, my wife has shared with me, that grace always comes before peace. If you want peace in your life, you have to accept God's grace. If you don't accept his grace, you'll always be in turmoil. You'll always be remembering those sins. And I ask a guy, well, I ask a lot of guys, if God forgives my sin, why do I still remember it? Is that a good one, huh? You know, like, hey, that thing I did in the eighth grade, God, that's troubling me. That's really troubling me. And then, you know, back when I was 16, you could drink when you were 18. So I figured I might as well get an early start on life, you know. And I still remember that, God, and it still really bugs me, some of those things I did when I was 16. And God's kind of like, I don't remember. You see, God's forgiven it. Now, people from my hometown, they remember it. But God's forgiven it, and he's forgot it. Grace. The next slide is to help you put your hands around this. God's riches at Christ's expense. You see, God paid the debt for my sin. I couldn't do anything. I couldn't mow lawns to pay for it. I couldn't carry groceries in for widows. I couldn't help a little old lady across the street to cover up my sin. I couldn't go to Sunday school every single Sunday of the year to pay for my sin. I couldn't be a double tither to pay for my sin. I couldn't go in the mission field for 40 years, which I've done. But that didn't pay for my sin. Just accepting that free gift of Jesus Christ, that paid the price for my sin. And the cool benefit is God's forgotten all my sin. So then, grace. Romans 6. What shall we say then? If grace is a good thing, if that just makes God better, if God's just, every time we sin and he forgives us, it's like a woo-ha party in heaven and all the angels rejoice, then man, we'd ought to just keep on sinning because then there'd be more parties in heaven. But Paul corrects us with that when he says, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning that grace may increase? For a human, that seems like a good idea. By no means, we died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. See, when we die to sin, we should allow that Holy Spirit to convict us that we don't want anything to do with that anymore. It should just be repulsive. Now, each person has a different sin struggle. There are many things in my life that tempted me terribly when I was younger that don't tempt me at all anymore. I'm the designated driver these days. And I'm usually one of the first ones to ask to leave the establishment because I'm having too much fun, and they cut me off from my Diet Coke. I have no desire to be where I was when I was 16 or 17. I had the privilege of performing the marriage ceremony, not the wedding, but the marriage ceremony for one of my grandchildren, my first one. He was married just a few weeks ago. Went to the reception, and they had a DJ there. And Mama and I was one of the first ones on the dance floor, and we were one of the last ones off. And it was just a hoot. Well, I went up. They had a place that you could get some refreshments. And I know I can be tempted, so I went up and I said to them, hey, now look, 3 Diet Cokes, and that's the limit. I said, because when I was younger, I used to drink that rum straight. And I don't know, but somehow that Coke mixes in with the rum from like 40 years ago, and I can be a mess. So 3 is my limit. And when I went for the second one, the lady said to me, are you sure? And I says, yeah, I'm, you know. So I drank that. Well, the third one, I went up and I said, just give me water. I said, I'm going to be here another hour or two. Someone needed a ride home that night. I was ready to take them home. You have a sin that you struggle with. It's different than mine. I have a sin I struggle with. It's different than yours. Those sins are between you and God. Only God can deliver you from those sins, and only his blood can wash them away. The only way I know how to do that is to repent. And that's godly sorrow. 2 Corinthians 7:10 says, godly sorrow leads to repentance that has no regret. Now, if I was regretting the life I lived when I was 16, you can say, Jeff, you didn't repent. That's your problem. If you're regretting whatever that sin is that you've gave up, you haven't repented yet. When you repent from something, you change your mind. You change your mind from your way of thinking to God's way of thinking. That's the point when God can work with us. When we repent, we submit to Him, we submit to His Lordship. If He's going to be the Lord of our life, the King of Kings, we'll do what He asks us to say. The do's and don'ts. We got a slide mixed in there someplace that said, how many commandments did Jesus give us? That's a good question. Oh, the Israelites went over that. How many laws? We went over that one. It was 1,500 some. The sign. Now, one more. That could be lost in the internet world, too. And you see, they think it's just my phone. If my grandkids were here, they could go through it. I have trouble with technology. That's why I go to foreign countries to speak. We don't have any. So here's the next slide. Just envision this coming across there. How many commandments did Jesus give us? How many?
Two.
I wrote that to someone this week. They said 51. I said, that's close. That's close. And I think probably he did, because anything he said is a commandment. But I think this poor friend of mine counted them up, because I sent the text to him. It came back 52. And how do you answer that? I'm like, well, you're close. You know, you want to encourage him. Two he gave us. The first one, you can repeat with me, was something like this. Love the Lord thy God with all your heart, all your mind, all your strength, and all your soul. That's the first one. That's the first and greatest commandment. And I think he did that. You youpers, you probably could handle the 10 plus 6, 13 plus 1,500, because you're sharper people. You're closer to him. You're up. But us trolls, we could only handle the two. So for us, he said the second one's like this. It's like the first, but it's love your neighbor as yourself. He made it easy on us. So if you ever want to, you know, migrate down, we'd love on you, and you can just remember two. So the first one, love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. The second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. In doing so, you'll keep them all. We don't have to worry about whether or not I ought to get a tattoo, whether or not I ought to shave today. I looked in the mirror and I said, you know, I forgot my razor. But there's a scripture says don't do it, so I'm safe. You and I, we're all, the rest of them, I don't know. They probably putting peas and carrots together. So here's the deal. Read the word. When it convicts you, that's the Holy Spirit working on you. You know, maybe watching your stories is okay. The other people might think, you're watching that trash. Now, Reba, bless her heart. Anybody out there watch The Voice? This saved me from a lot of condemnation at that wedding. Because, you know, I had to bust a couple of moves, and there was a couple of songs I couldn't hear what they were. And later on, the grandkids were like, Grandpa, you were dancing to that? And I pulled the Reba card right out of my pocket. And Reba said, I didn't understand the word they was saying, but I sure enjoyed it, and they was cute as a button. So if anybody said to you I was, you know, out of character at the wedding reception, I didn't understand the word they said, but I sure enjoyed it. Now, Jesus would sure enjoy it a bunch if there was anybody out there who hadn't repented of your sins and hadn't given their life to Christ. The one thing about Michigan, upper or lower, you can't go any direction within 3 miles and find water deep enough to baptize somebody. If there's somebody here who just hasn't done it yet, and they thought it was just all too complicated, I hope we dumbed it down for you today. There's not a bunch of rules you got to live by. There's just two. And the biggest thing is you just have to recognize you're a sinner. And there's water everywhere. And today, you can give your life to Christ. And that's what it's all about. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving us. I thank you for this body. I thank you for what they do collectively and what they do individually in this community. We pray for great things here, Lord. We pray that people would see the light that you've brought to them, because there's truly a world walking in darkness. Help each one of us here, Lord, to share our story with others so they can realize that, wow, God can forgive that. They could forgive me. So God, help us to be a light that others might see how much you love us. And thank you for giving us your Son, who shed his precious blood, that each one of us who come to him in repentance will be forgiven. Help us, Lord, to be your hands and feet this week. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.